Hi everyone, I'm Lou. I decided to call my talk this afternoon, Look Before You Leap, because when I was about 10 years old, my mum gave me a book with the same title. Now, although I didn't read the book, because I actually couldn't sit still that long, the message was really clear. She wanted me to stop being so impulsive. Yep, from the moment I could walk, I was into everything and I was constantly on the move. Running, climbing, dancing, exploring. I actually couldn't keep still, and I couldn't keep my hands to myself. I would touch everything, because everything was just so interesting. So I broke things too, sometimes other people's things. And please believe me when I say I didn't mean to. And I didn't mean to lose their things either. I also never shut up. I talked incessantly without a filter from the moment I got up in the morning to the moment I went to bed at night. And really, I didn't actually pay much attention to whether anyone was listening or whether they were even interested. I just kept on going. And I interrupted people all the time because I just could not keep the thoughts that were pounding my head at a million miles an hour from coming out of my mouth. And I was emotional and highly sensitive too. For example, if I was in trouble for even the slightest thing, I would feel physically sick. And if my sister teased me or was mean to me, my big, overwhelming emotions would basically take over, and I'd find myself either crying hysterically or hitting out, kicking and screaming. And I always made decisions on a whim, without thinking through the consequences. Decisions that caused me harm, that got me in trouble at school, often socially isolated me, and sometimes embarrassed my mum, which really hurt. In fact, the hurt I felt deep down in my core was absolutely excruciating, overwhelming, and debilitating. For I always tried so damn hard to please my mum and my dad and to make them proud of me. And I really wanted to be liked, to be appreciated, to fit in with the crowd, desperately. But instead, I was always wrong, always in trouble, and always rejected. And as a result, I started to believe that there was something innately wrong with me, that I was bad, that I was broken, for I was the naughty child. But although my mum struggled with me and often felt like she was banging her head against a brick wall, she also loved me. Hence, she was hoping that if she just pointed out that, you know, if you could just look before you leap, things would actually improve. The problem was, I couldn't, not at 10 years old. Not at 20 either, or at 30, no matter how many times she asked me to. At 47 years of age, I found out why. For at 47 years old, I was diagnosed with, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, or ADHD. And I don't know why I'm crying. The disorder that robs individuals of the ability to pause and willfully exert self-control. And the disorder that many people don't even believe exists. The one surrounded by stigma and the false assertions that, you know, if the kid's got ADHD, that's a load of crap. Just give them a quick flip under the ear and it'll all be done with. It'll be gone. But that doesn't work. There are copious studies now that show that the brains of individuals with ADHD differ from neurotypical individuals in many ways. And because of this, we do not develop the executive control, which is a fancy word for self-control, in the same way our peers do, and to the same degree. And as a result, we struggle to focus and process information without interruptions, to develop self-awareness and accurate self-perception, to inhibit our words, thoughts, and actions and emotions, to recall memories in the form of pictures and in words. We struggle to self-motivate and to delay gratification, to plan and prioritize, and to negotiate social situations effectively. Now, with your permission, I would really like to give you some insight into what it's like to live with ADHD. Imagine being constantly distracted by anything that's more interesting than the important task that you're trying to focus on. And no matter how much you try so hard to stay on track, you can't just stay on track and get it done, even though there are severe negative consequences. Imagine trying to struggle or struggling to filter external noises, sights and sounds for relevance, as everything appears just as loud as everything else, and everything appears just as important, whilst at the same time being bombarded by your thoughts constantly, many of which aren't even relevant to the moment or to the situation you're in. So that makes it really hard for you to stay focused and on track, even when you're talking to someone you dearly love. Yep, sometimes I wish my brain would just shut up. Imagine not always being able to filter your words that come out of your mouth. And as a result, you find yourself interrupting others, blurting out comments at inappropriate times, or suffering foot and mouth. Just like the time when I told a lady from Mother's Group that I felt like a dirty old car salesman when I was trying to sell my services as a health coach. I had a picture of Danny DeVito on my head from the, you know, the movie Matilda. Unfortunately, her husband sold cars for a living. Actually, my dad did too, when I was younger, and I'd forgotten all about that. Imagine trying to remember people's names or the kids' names, the people you really care about that are in your lives, but your brain refuses to give you that information when you need it in the moment. When this happens, you know you're coming across as being socially inadequate and being perceived as being weird. Whilst on the inside, your anxiety takes over, you're full of embarrassment and shame because you desperately want to connect. Being close to people is really important to you, but your brain is completely blank. And imagine being so highly sensitive and feeling your emotions so intensely that the responses that you have to normal situations seem like they're totally blown out of proportion to other people, and hence why my mum used to call me the drama queen. And lastly, imagine what all those experiences have on your mental health, your self-esteem, and your self-worth. For along with that, being constantly criticised or in trouble for not being able to look before you leave, being told to try harder, to sit still, to focus, even though you're trying your darn hardest, and failing to achieve your goals because of the way your brain's wired, and not being able to do a bloody thing about it, even as an adult. This is the effect it had on me. I grew up feeling ashamed, inadequate, feeling unworthy and regretful, and I believed that I was fundamentally different, flawed, even broken. And as a result, over time, I developed anxiety and depression and an eating disorder. And I started to self-medicate with alcohol as a means of coping with my crippling self-doubt and the pain I felt inside. Even though over the years I learned to actually manage those things and I started to achieve my goals, like I became a wound care stomal therapy nurse in a hospital. At one stage I even managed the whole hospital overnight. But there were still some arenas of my life that I just couldn't manage. As I struggled, my memory would always let me down. I couldn't negotiate social situations well and manage my emotions. And as a result, I found myself, even until my mid-40s, regularly drowning in that god-awful black hole and wondering how the hell I was going to climb back out of it. And it's not a place I would want anyone to ever visit. Thankfully, I don't go there anymore. But even though I still have my ADHD challenges, they're never going to go away. I no longer feel inadequate or broken, nor do I rely on the destructive crutches to help me navigate life anymore. Instead, I've learned to accept myself fully and to love myself unconditionally, warts and all. Now, not in a I'm too big for my boots kind of self or better than anyone else kind of self way, because that's not love, that's fear. But in a I accept myself completely, take full responsibility for myself and my actions, and treat myself as my own best friend kind of way. And I feel like I'm thriving, for I love my life and I love the people in it. For I've learned to embrace my strengths and to put in place strategies that help me manage my challenges and negotiate life more successfully. And this includes taking stimulant medication and using externalized reminders that help me to look before I leap that work about 90% of the time. I say that's winner. And learnt to speak up for myself, and I still am. I'm learning to ask for understanding and for assistance in the people that matter most in my life. That's not to say my ADHD challenges don't challenge me anymore. Like I said, they do, and they're going to forever. And I've got a son with ADHD, and his challenges actually make it mine even, you know, they magnify them even further. But I'm more at peace with myself now and my journey, and I choose to use those challenges or to look at them as if they're an opportunity to learn and to grow. So in closing, I want you to know a couple of things. If you're an adult with ADHD who's struggling, you are not alone, because that's how you feel at times, but you're not. Nor are you stupid, crazy, or lazy. The reason you cannot look before you leap is because you're wired differently and therefore haven't learnt to use the strategies and tools you need to actually achieve your goals yet. But you can, for it's very possible to live a full and rewarding life with ADHD. Secondly, if you're a parent of a young child with ADHD, or a teacher or a grandparent, please don't ask the child to look before they can leap. They can't, not yet. However, with your unconditional love and support, as well as the treatment that they need, based on best practice guidelines, they will. But it will take time and patience. However, your effort will be worth it, because it's easier to build up a child with ADHD than it is to repair a broken adult. And lastly, if you don't have ADHD or a child with ADHD, I want you to know that you still play a vital part in the outcomes of those who do. For your perception of kids and adults with ADHD, whether you accept, judge, or reject us, and how you respond to us, greatly affects how we experience our life and what we think about ourselves. For all of us with ADHD, we'll be forever grateful if the stigma would just disappear and the people would greet us with compassion and understanding, and especially greet our kids in that manner. This is why I've taken so much time to explain to you what living with ADHD is like, for our community really needs your help, please. For everyone deserves to thrive, even the kid who was labelled naughty. Thank you.